I love ketchup as much as the next man, but some people really love ketchup. Like, weird love.
Are you just going into Leon?
Yeah.
Before you do, I just wanted to ask you a quick question. I'm making a film for Leon about ketchup, and I just wondered, are you a fan of ketchup?
Oh, I love ketchup. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah? Yeah. You're a fan of ketchup?
Yeah, definitely.
You've liked it since day dot?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Why'd you love it?
Because it was anything.
Well, my dad puts it on everything as well, so the same.
What's the weirdest thing you've ever put it on?
Weirdest thing I've ever salad? Is that weird?
Noodles.
I have tried it on salted popcorn.
Salted popcorn?
Yeah.
That's weird.
It was alright. Probably wouldn't go again, but it was alright.
Like, that is weird. That's weird.
It's vegetable.
How do you feel being weird? But I used to put ketchup on my cottage pie. But that was when I was a little bit younger. Like, you still...
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you. Enjoy your Leon.
I had it last night, dinner.
People are weird. Well, if you think that's weird, check out the history.
Our journey starts in southeastern China in the 17th century. The Chinese made a sauce mixing pickled fermented fish and spices, and the name of this sauce? Ketchup. By the early 18th century, the fermented dark sauce had made its way to Malaysia and Singapore and into the gobs of English colonists. Soon after, ketchup began to appear in British and then American cookbooks. But this wasn't the ketchup we know today. Most British recipes called for ingredients like walnuts, oysters, anchovies, and most commonly, mushrooms. In fact, mushroom ketchup was purported to be Jane Austen's favourite condiment. Bless her. But at this point, we're still missing a certain ingredient. Enter centre stage, darling, the tomato. This juicy little fella started getting incorporated into the sauce around the early 1800s. However, the preservation of tomato ketchup proved a little bit problematic, with many sauces containing contaminants like spores, bacteria, mould, and yeast. Leading the celeb chef of the day, French cookbook author Pierre Blot, to call commercial ketchup
filthy, decomposed, putrid.
Anyway, the first attempts at commercial preservatives weren't any better either, with early ketchups containing dangerous levels of, wait for it, coal tar,
sodium benzoate, and yeah, putrid tomatoes.
By the end of the 19th century, Harvey Washington Wiley maintained that the use of these harmful preservatives was totally unnecessary if fresh produce was used. Wiley partnered with a Pittsburgh man named Henry J. Hines, I've heard of him, who was convinced the answer to the benzoate controversy was to use fresh, ripe, red tomatoes, which contain the natural preservative pectin, and increase the vinegar content to reduce the risk of spoilage.
What, using fresh ingredients? Who'd have thought of that? But I guess that really does point out and demonstrate that back then, people didn't understand the importance of fresh ingredients or safe, sanitary working conditions. Hines and Wiley were the entrepreneurs of the day that were innovating and coming up with what would change the industry for good. They really are the forefathers of safe, healthy, scalable food manufacturing that we take for granted today. They were both really influential men of the day. Wiley, for example, he was the guy behind the 1906 Pure Food and Drug Act, and he was the first commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration in the US. And Hines was just an incredible entrepreneur who had a parental relationship with his workers, giving free healthcare and both recreational and cultural facilities. But primarily, both men were the guys that said, you need to have safe, sanitary working conditions. And that's the key thing that was a game changer and turned Hines into this bottle of ketchup that's pretty much in everybody's cupboard. But recently, ketchup, well, it's been falling out of favour. Something to do with its high sugar content.
You see, in your box standard household ketchup, a 15 gram serving, which is a teaspoon, well, almost as much as 5 grams of it could be sugar. That's a third of that teaspoon would be sugar.
That's quite a lot, isn't it? Now, as a result, alternative ketchups are coming out into the market, and Leon have launched their own, but they've made it with beetroot. So I'm gonna see if the ketchup nutters from earlier will try it and if they'll convert. Come on. They have their own mini Leon in the office so they can train everybody.
That's class.
Ready? Don't hold it. Does it have less sugar?
Less sugar?
Yeah.
Because beetroot's naturally sweet,
yeah,
and so its sweetness replaces the refined sugar that you would use. Okay. Honest opinion. Go.
like sweet and sour stuff. Vinegar,
like a tangy kind of aftertaste, but it's nice. Beetrooty,
it's very beetrooty, very earthy.
How would you describe it? That face is amazing.
You've got to
not the biggest fan of ketchup. Okay. No, not ketchup, biggest fan of beetroot.
Okay.
I like it.
Yeah.
Has it got the sweetness that ketchup has and the tanginess?
Yeah, definitely.
Would you use that in replacement?
No, I wouldn't.
You wouldn't.
No.
Yeah, I can happily.
You would, yeah?
Mm-hmm. No, I would like it separately.
You like the ketchup?
Yeah, ketchup and mince.
And mince. This is a new ketchup.
It's a new ketchup.
Yeah,
it's a new category.
You're going to add it to your ketchup collection, basically.
Yeah.
You've got a ketchup collection?
Yeah.
So there you have it. The history of ketchup and what goes into it. It would seem that not everybody's willing to move on from their beloved ketchup just yet, but each to their own, eh? What? Spaghetti and ketchup? It's not weird.